private institutions. But by 2006, the share of private institutions went up to 51.5%, and today it must be in the range of 65 to 70%. So 70% of students in higher education are in private sector institutions. In legal parlance, we have a concept called res ipsa loquitur, which means facts are speaking for themselves. And in such a situation, no evidence is required to be adduced. Today, it is a well-recognized fact that it has been private sector that has really driven capacity creation in higher education. We need to encourage more and more private investment in the higher education and find a solution to the debate for profit or not for profit. The Apex Court has held that education, including higher education, is a non-profit activity. The court has also held that right to establish and administer educational institutions under Article 19 and 30 is not a trade, business, or profession, but indeed an occupation. Thus, no profiteering or capitation fee can be allowed, but the court has permitted that unaided private institutions may devise their own fee structure so that they can efficiently run these institutions. They are also allowed reasonable surplus for future expansion. This reasonable surplus has to be plowed back into the institution while keeping intact the overall non-profit nature of educational institution. We need to do more to attract private investment in the higher education, and this is the point I mentioned. I want to elaborate a little bit. The Planning Commission Working Group report on public-private partnership in higher education has suggested at stepping up budgetary outlays and creating public-private partnership to enhance the number of higher education institutions. The approach document of 12th plan says higher education accounts for 18% of public funding on education, or 1.12% of GDP, which should ideally be raised to 25%. This translates into an additional allocation of 25,000 crores to higher education. You had a session on RUSA. It's a non-starter. Nobody has got a penny, not a penny under RUSA. And you will see that there is a change of government and maybe this scheme as such goes. Public-private partnership would be an improvement over an exclusively private institutions, as many of them indeed do have profit motives. There can be a number of models for public-private partnership, such as where private sector invests in infrastructure and runs the place while the government pays for it, where private sector makes investment in infrastructure but government runs the institutions, or where investments are shared by the government and the private sector but operations are handed over to private sector, and finally where the government invests in infrastructure but private sector is entrusted with the responsibility to run the operations. And this is my last point. The New Companies Act 2013 has now mandated 2% allocation for corporate social responsibility, which can easily be used for higher education. We must establish National Education Finance Corporation and National Education Loan Fund. We need to give permission to private institutions to raise funds through public offering of bonds and share. So let Manu also go to the equity market and see how market rates Manu. We need to allow these private institutions to convert themselves into Section 25 companies under the Companies Act. The International Islamic University in Malaysia, sir, is a company. So convert themselves into Section 25 companies, and finally we need to designate these private institutions of higher education as infrastructure. They are infrastructure. To allow them legal and tax benefits which are available to other big infrastructure projects. At the same time, these private institutions should not become mere degree-selling shops. Many private universities today make tall claims in respect of their flexible academic system, choice-based credit policy, and industry-relevant curricula. But I am sorry to say that in many cases, these claims are not visible on their campuses, but exist only in their admission advertisements, websites, and brochures. Many universities in private sector simply copy the academic structure and course outlines from leading universities of the world, but they fail to deliver as necessary operational procedures to implement these ambitious courses an adequate and latest teaching methodology have not been put in place. The other flip side of our private institutions is that they misuse or abuse their autonomy and initiate courses in niche areas without adequate planning, proper infrastructure facilities, or necessary recruitment. And finally, and this is my last point, I'll just skip a few things. What is the purpose of education? What is the ultimate purpose of university education? John Stuart Mill rightly answered way back in 1867. Universities are not intended to teach the knowledge required to fit men for some special mode of giving their livelihood. Their object is not to make a skillful lawyer or physicians or engineers, but capable and cultivated human beings. Men are men before they are lawyers or physicians or merchants or manufacturers. If you make them capable and sensible men, they will make themselves capable and sensible lawyers or physicians. These words of wisdom from one of the most influential political thinkers of 19th century, in my opinion, are relevant for all of us, as we should not view universities merely as a way of securing a job, and for the administrators of the universities to understand that educational institutions are not supposed to produce just competent professionals. We need to produce not only competent professionals, but socially sensitive and socially relevant professionals. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We, Department of Management and Commerce, as a mark of gratitude, we thanks Professor Faizan Mustafa Sahab by presenting a memento. I request our Dean, Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Sahab, to present the memento to Professor Faizan Mustafa Sahab. Singh, Vice Chancellor, IFLO University, to address the occasion. Professor Sunaina Singh, Vice.
Dr. Shahid Sahib, Dr. Iqbal Ahmed, and Dr. Fatima, and dear friends. Good afternoon and namaskar to all of you. I must thank Manu for having me here this afternoon as the chief guest. I was wondering what role am I going to play for the valedictory, because I know that all of you would have spent very fruitful 2 days, discussing and debating on various aspects, as diverse as the perspectives, the challenges, the strategies of higher education. So, whither to higher education? What is the role of higher education? Where does it want to channelize its resources into? What is the route that it needs to take? I think this is something that all of us in higher education reflect upon. Very often, as my friend Faizan Saab has mentioned, it's not easy to be heading institutions any longer. You know, those are the challenges that we have to face, and the challenges multiply per day. Because apart from RTIs, I must mention, Faizan Saab, I must draw your attention. You are perhaps inundated with RTIs on the, travel and the lunch, whatever. You know, I get an RTI on the number of teas consumed in my room if the guests come. So I tell my PAs to keep a count on the piala of chai that comes. I said, this is for the benefit of my RTI. You know, what amazes me is the amount of time we have to waste. What are our youngsters doing? What are our faculty doing? Or what are our so-called responsible citizens doing if they're wasting so much time trying to get information on cups of tea or how many times you travel away from the city or what is one trying to get for the university, what is the money that has been received by the university, which is there anyway on the website, I thought. But anyway, higher education is some, is a factor that needs to be reflected upon periodically. We are in a time zone where we talk about the humongous growth pattern of higher education. You know, generally, if you talk to UGC, you talk to ministry, they talk about the humongous growth pattern. And they are right there, because we have over 600 and odd universities in the country, highest number of institutions, school or universities. And we find that there are a lot of youngsters, when they step out of the portals of the university, they're not able to get a job for themselves. Now, what was the role of the university is something that we need to ask, because one spends 5 years on an average in a university, undergraduate and postgraduate together, and one is looking for a job. I would question what is the role of the university, and probably we have to look at it this way. Is the role that of dissemination of knowledge? Is it knowledge transfer that one is talking about? Or is it production of knowledge? University must produce knowledge, must prepare minds to ask questions that have never been asked before, look for answers themselves, find the answers, because the answers lie within you. You need to explore the research capabilities of a student. So the university per se must train the student not merely to study and get prepared for an exam and then pass out with a distinction, as most of our generation did. You know, the focus was different. Today you find that everybody is a distinction holder. It's very easy to get very high marks. But even with that, the competition is so bad that one does not get placed in an institution, in an organization, in an industry of one's choice. You know, that is the problem about higher education. Because higher education has to attune itself to the requirement of a nation. As students of management, when we look at the universities, we find that we are training students to collate their marks, to collate their percentage, and then move on to acquiring a job. What happens 10 years down the line, once you have a job in the industry? Does it sustain you? Does it satisfy you? Is a question that we need to ask. I think it's very important, therefore, periodically, to reassess our goals. Knowledge for the sake of knowledge is not going to lead us anywhere. Knowledge for development is what is important, you know. That is what we need to look out for. Mark Twain was once traveling in a train, and he was asked by the ticket collector for the ticket, as the ticket collector was moving through that compartment. And Mark Twain started looking for the ticket. He couldn't find it. So very patiently, the ticket collector waited for 2 minutes. And then he looked at him and said, "Mark, we all know. I am sure you have the ticket somewhere." And he walked past. He came back 45 minutes down the same compartment. And he found Mark Twain with all the papers next to him. He's still searching for that ticket. So the ticket collector says, "Mark, we all know about your integrity. There's no need for you to look for the ticket. I'm sure it's somewhere there." Mark Twain looks up at him very quixotically and says, "Well, it's not for you. I need to know where I'm going." You know, it's so relevant, because if you think about it, I'm sure Mark Twain knows which station he has to disembark. It's not that, but he's trying to search his mind as to the purpose of going there. You know, when you arrive somewhere, one should know why one is there. So the purpose of education is also to arrive somewhere. It is not amassing of knowledge. It is not just about information. I think it was T.S. Eliot who actually mourned. He said, "In search of information are we losing knowledge." You know, he mourned this fact. He said that, why are we groping for information? Do you have the knowledge? And then he goes, takes the next step and says, in quest of knowledge, are we losing wisdom? So we need to ask further. We need to probe further and find out whether we are carrying the sagacity within us, the wisdom within us, to know the purpose of education. Is it merely to beget us a job? Yes, where livelihood is concerned, it is important. It is very important to have a job. But then, you know, a man is not made of, by what one gets from life, but man should be defined by what he gives to life, what he brings to life. So I think that is where the culture comes in, where the tahzeeb comes in, where the value systems come in. You know, I was looking at the 50-odd papers, and I find, there's something on the ethical values and all. But I was quickly glancing, and I found only one paper on gender. You know, I was wondering, and I'm glad Faizan Saab said, it's not somebody, we empowering somebody else. I think we should learn to empower ourselves. So knowledge should be for that. We need to empower ourselves. So how do we do it is where education comes. So universities play a very limited role. My friend already spoke about what is ailing higher education in India. Very little funding, too much of regulation, with the result that one is not able to breathe easy. There's a lot of talk about autonomy of an institution, but that autonomy is not extended in reality. You know? So the meaning of autonomy is lost. One is stifled in an institution because you find that you are only looking at books, amassing knowledge there, information, I must say. Now, this can be very frustrating. As head of an institution, I generally ask my faculty, what is your research quotient? What do you do where research is concerned? And they say, well, we are reading this novel, we are doing this, we are doing that. I generally say that research needs to be disseminated in conferences and seminars. It's very important that the outcome of a conference is put together, not just in the form of book, but also some of the suggestions for the growth and development of the country must be sent to the policymakers. Otherwise, you lose the significance of that conference. There might be some good papers which might be making some very productive and proactive suggestions. It's important to share that knowledge with the policymakers, with the government. Now, the government per se lacks any kind of respect for the institutions. When you share your ideas, you know, those are not respected. Then one wonders, when you hold these conferences and seminars, it's all for research. When you next present another paper on management of higher education, I'm sure the book that will be collated will be very, very useful to you. But my concern is, how is it going to help the country? If we are looking for the next step that Mark Twain was concerned about, if I do disembark, I need to do something there. I need to achieve some goal. So it is the reassessment of goals periodically which is very important, which is missing in higher education. Now, where challenges are concerned, I think institutions suffer from a lot of ailments. Because you find that while you might have your timetables, you might have your courses, my concern, major concern is with academic auditing. You know, are we reassessing our syllabi periodically? Do we look at the relevance of the courses that are being offered? Do they fetch them the jobs that they look for? And whenever I think about jobs, I also think about, fine, you might get a job today, but will you be able to retain that job? You know? So 5 years down the line, 10 years down the line, as the market changes globally, your knowledge also needs to change. because one will not be able to sustain the job unless you update your knowledge. So periodically, you need to take another look at the courses that are offered. The auditing has to be done at the academic level. If we do not do that, then perhaps we are still in the 17th century where knowledge is concerned. You know, we may not have arrived in the 21st century, some areas. So universities periodically need to update their knowledge, need to take a closer look at the courses that are being offered, the relevance of the courses. Now, some of the humanities universities, like my own university, you know, languages are important, or MANUU for that matter. I was looking at this grading system. There's a lot of talk about why are we not there in the top 100 universities of the world? And that question does not bother me at all, because I think we have to be very clear what we need in our universities. And I think our parameters of higher education is social justice. So if you talk about social justice, let's balance it. We want to give free education. We want to, accord respect to a part of a society who were probably not given the kind of benefits that they deserved. So we have a social justice formula working. If we have that, how do you balance that with excellence? Because in the class itself, you will have three rungs of students. Some might be excellent, some may not be. So are we trying to take away self-esteem from them? What is it that we want to achieve? I think at the national level, there has to be a debate on what is the purpose of higher education. You know, or you groom your students or give them free education right from the primary level. Because RUSA, we all know, is not going to take off really. You find that in principle, policies are being created. But how valid are they? How relevant will they be? Will depend on the next government. Because they would like to decide. Right now, they want to decide who will be the incoming person, who will go out. So when you do not have a holistic way of looking at the educational pattern in the country, I don't think we can move forward. If you ask me, in a nutshell, I would say we lack the vision to move forward. We do not have a coherent vision of higher education. Because if, you know, as long as we are clear about the vision, the goals will happen automatically. That's not going to happen unless the government says that some of the heads of the institution, some scholars, some scientists, some writers, come together and think about what is it that we want to give to our youngsters. Because I think India is the only country that has the youngest of population in the world. So for next 20 years, India or the Indian youth will be ruling over the world. And our youth, when they go abroad, they do exceedingly well. We all know that. Lot of diligence and discipline abroad. But we don't have the same diligence and discipline back home. Because we allow them to get away. We allow them to get away with degrees, with mediocrity. We do not challenge them. So I think we must learn. We must learn to chase our goals, chase our dreams. But first, set the benchmarks for ourselves, you know? Have a goal which is of the highest order. Don't be too satisfied with mediocrity. Because whenever one would want to compete, one must compete with the best, not with the others. I think that's very important where higher education is concerned. I'm not going to take more time here, but I would like to say that when youngsters move into the second phase of their life, I would expect them to take their values forward. It's very important. It was Martin Luther King Jr. who said that it is character plus knowledge which makes education. So education is equal to knowledge plus character. If you don't have the character, or the values, no knowledge is ever going to be helpful to you. I think it's very important to hold on to our value system. India has a lot to give in terms of culture and values. The whole world would like to learn from us in that sphere. I think we need to study on our own culture. We need to carry forward our value system. I think that's what you could give along with your competence and ability. Thank you on that.
Thank you very much, madam. I request Pro Vice Chancellor Dr. Khaja Muhammad Shahid to present the moment to Chief Guest Professor Sunaina Singh. Khaja Muhammad Shahid, Pro Vice Chancellor Manu, to give his presidential address.
Professor Sunaina Singh, Chief Guest of the Veterinary Function, Professor Faizan Mustafa, the keynote speaker, Professor K.R. Akbar, Dr. Saneem Fatima, colleagues from MANUU, young students, faculty, ladies and gentlemen. I think it's a very difficult task for me to stand before you and speak something about higher education or issues which you have been discussing for the last 2 days after speeches by two illustrious vice chancellors and academicians and their thought-provoking speeches. Ladies and gentlemen, as I was telling you yesterday, and I do not hesitate to repeat the same thing today, that why we have this seminar, why we design this seminar, why we plan this seminar. The topic seems to be very rhetoric. Topic does not seem to be very something new. But we all felt in this university, and particularly the designers of this program and planners of this program, of this seminar, that new challenges are there. And surely, the two speakers today and earlier speakers yesterday in the inaugural session and subsequent papers in the technical session must have thrown open new points, and definitely they have thrown open new points that the higher education now requires new challenges. Now look at the point which Mr. Faizan Mustafa has just made. Universities should go to stock market. Now, do you think that 20 years back or 30 years back, any vice chancellor could think of going to stock market, share market, floating shares and selling shares? Now you have to have full knowledge of SEBI and companies and so forth. This is a new challenge because there's a crunch of resources. So you have to think of new ways of raising resources. Similarly, new goals. Professor Sunaina Singh has mentioned that this knowledge and character and so forth. Now, these are new challenges which are there. Therefore, the question which remains, to my mind, very prime question, that all those things which we have talked about, the education should deliver, education should have, how should we manage it, the question remains that now managing higher education requires some new techniques. And we have to think about those new techniques. We have to think about those new technological development which are coming up. We have to think about those new skills which we do not know, perhaps we do not know at this stage today. Perhaps we have to plan them, we have to think them, and we have to evolve them. Vice-chancellors, two vice-chancellors have also expressed that difficult to manage universities. They have expressed their difficulties. They have expressed their concern. I know sometime very good people, when we approach them to take the charge as a vice chancellor, I can say with some confidence about the Aligarh Muslim University, which I have some close association, people refuse to take the responsibility of the vice chancellorship. I remember long back talking to a former then vice chancellor of Delhi University, Professor Muniz Raza, and he said, "Now my problem is, you know, Shahid, I do not meet good teachers. All the time as a vice chancellor, I meet people who are coming with narebazi, coming with some jhola, people are coming with the slogans. Most of the time there are agitation outside my room. I do not meet good faculty." Now the vice chancellor is finding difficult to meet good faculty in their office and then their tenure as a vice chancellor. Point I am trying to drive at, ladies and gentlemen, and distinguished speaker sitting on the dais. All those difficulties are coming day by day, new and new difficulties, both in terms of resources, in terms of challenges, competitions, world over competition. Azan Mustafa has very elaborately explained all those points in his valedictory address. Now, my point is that all these require new techniques, new challenges have to be met with new skills. And therefore, the management and new strategies are required. That's the point when then we thought of this seminar. And I'm sure that focus should remain. That's why, as I said yesterday, that's why I repeated today, this seminar was given to Department of Management and Commerce. This seminar was not given to some other department, which may be traditionally Department of Education or some other department. I'm repeating it myself at the cost of repetition, because I think modern techniques of management are required to be deployed in the university management, as the corporate world are deploying modern techniques of management. Azan Mustafa said some Malaysian example, the companies are being set up under Section 25, and in India also you can say non-profitable companies and set up education. So some schools are being set up, colleges are being set up under Section 25 of Indian Companies Act, so and so forth. Now, could you think of a vice chancellor or a director of IIT, say 20 years back or 30 years back, facing all those problems? No. Challenges with new administrators of higher education institutions. And same applies to macro level. Same applies to macro level. A new project, RUSA, has been launched with high fanfare. Everybody is talking about that. You have just heard two vice chancellors. I have talked to some other vice chancellor. Other day I was talking in Delhi to the vice chancellor of Jawaharlal Nehru University. And he was expressing his very high dissatisfaction with RUSA. And his concern was that, yes, it's there, is very good, but at the cost of universities. At the cost of universities, you're launching this project. At the cost of higher education, your institutions, you're launching this project. So, ladies and gentlemen, the point which I want to draw in the end, that whether it's a policy planners, whether it's an administrator, whether it's a manager, whether down the line the universities, the IITs, the IIMs, people who are sitting as vice chancellors, directors, registrars, provost chancellors, or deans, etc., they all require to have certain skills to manage new challenges and new goals and objectives we are all talking about. And these challenges and goals definitely were not there 20, 30 years, 50 years back. Therefore, I think, for example, this point which he was talking about, RTI. Now, RTI, all of us are scared. All of us are scared. I don't know whether I have told you it earlier or not, but I'm tempted to tell you, when this act was in the form of a bill, it was circulated to all of us in Government of India, to all senior officers. At that point of time, I was in UPSC. And all of us in UPSC, without any single exception, all felt, what a law, what a difficult law. Now we cannot work. How can we work under this act? And UPSC as an organization approached the government to exempt it from the purview of RTI Act. Of course, we did not succeed. We are now managing, and we have to manage it. And there are means and ways to